She had the world at her fingertips.
She was very outgoing, very fearless.
She was just a smart young lady.
The sky was the limit.
And it looked like she'd found the love of her life, too.
She introduced him to the family.
She was taken with this guy. She loved him.
Until tragedy stole her too soon.
Blood was coming out her mouth.
911, do you need police?
She's on the ground.
Just a roller coaster of emotions surged through my body.
Detectives move quickly to identify a suspect.
The name came from another resident that did not want to be identified.
He wanted something more than friendship.
And the killer's explanation would be full of excuses.
He said he woke up in a haze.
The drugs made him go crazy.
But were they also enough for him to get away with murder?
It was a slap in the face.
It'll never be okay.
He knew exactly what he was doing.
We're just friends.
October 2nd, 2015. It's Friday night in Charlotte, North Carolina, a thriving metropolis of more than 2 million.
Charlotte, North Carolina is a really big city and it's growing every day.
It's a great town. It has a growing financial sector, which is really driving a lot of people to the area.
Although like any city, parts of Charlotte still struggle.
Some of the city's challenges are definitely crime. And education is another one of those real serious issues.
The city's growth had also made safe, affordable housing very hard to find.
It's 9:30 that night when Brittany Mayfield returns to the apartment where she lives with her daughter and sister.
The apartment was in a new complex built by the local housing authority.
The neighborhood, for the most part, was a quiet, family-oriented neighborhood.
Lexi is Brittany's little sister, 23-year-old Alexia Mayfield.
Alexia had recently moved into the apartment with her sister. While the sister went to work, she would watch the child.
I called maybe an hour before I got off. She didn't answer the phone, so I thought maybe, of course, she probably sleep.
Inside, Brittany finds her daughter in the living room.
Brittany's baby was peacefully asleep.
Lexi? Then, careful not to wake the baby, Brittany heads back to her sister's bedroom.
Lexi. What happened?
She found her sister on the floor.
She see blood coming from Lexi's mouth. She tapped her. She wasn't moving, but her body wasn't cold. It was warm.
Oh my God, Lexi.
In a panic, Brittany calls 911 in hopes they can save her sister. But will it be too late? Outgoing 23-year-old Alexia Mayfield was always the center of attention.
Alexia and Brittany were very social, had lots of friends and lots of love in their community.
People gravitated toward her.
I was a quiet one. Lexi was the outgoing one, always loud. Laughing, goofy.
Alexia was the life of the party. You never had a dull moment being around her. She's very bright, smart, funny.
She seemed to make everybody laugh.
She was a very fun woman. And she was so confident. So confident about herself.
She was very fearless. She spoke her mind. Even though I'm the oldest, Lexi was more like the backbone, really.
Alexia was always ready to lend a sympathetic ear, too.
She was really nice, real sweet, caring.
She was genuinely concerned about people. She always wanted to help people. When Alexia was younger, she would say, "I want to be a teacher when I grow up like you, Mommy." And I don't know whether she said it to make her mommy happy or whether she said it out of sincerity, but, you know, children do that. When they're younger, they have a tendency to want to please their parents, and she told me she wanted to be a teacher like her mama.
Despite her earlier aspirations of becoming a teacher, after graduating high school in 2010, Alexia enrolled in an online college with the goal of becoming a pharmacy technician.
That's what she wanted to hone in on. And so we would go to the different places like CVS and see what their availabilities were. And she talked about it all the time. She was real excited.
Alexia was very ambitious and driven.
She wanted to make something of herself. That was her main goal. School was her number one priority.
She was just a smart young lady. She loved learning.
No one seemed to be more proud of her than her mother.
She was getting good grades, everything.
She didn't have to study very hard either.
With Lexi, the sky was the limit.
But no matter how high she soared, Lexi stayed close to her sister, Brittany. In 2014, the sisters moved in together, renting an apartment near the Charlotte airport.
Brittany was about to have a baby, and Alexia was looking forward to being a new aunt.
Alexia loves her niece very much, and her niece loves her.
However, a budding career and a new address weren't the only changes on the horizon for Lexi.
Hey, beautiful.
You talking to me?
What's up?
She told me that she was just walking down the street close to where she and her sister lived at the time. He pulled up beside her.
He was 25-year-old Emmanuel Felton.
There was definitely a spark there. They had a great conversation, and you could see that it was going to lead to something else.
She came back saying, I met this dude.
So the relationship started from that point.
They was always doing something new, something different, bike riding, going to the park, going to the mall, coming back with clothing. Lexi was definitely very happy.
He seemed to really love her, and she loved him, and she made that so clear. She made it so clear how she felt about Emmanuel.
She said, I have somebody that loves me just as much as I love him.
And to family and friends, they seemed like a great match.
I liked him, you know. I thought he was good for Lexi.
He worked at a cell phone place and does a lot of the technical side of cell phone service.
This was a good, steady relationship.
Before long, the couple was starting to think about taking the next step.
Emmanuel called me one afternoon, and he laid out this plan of how he was going to ask Alexia to marry him. Talked about the ring, the whole nine yards.
But the big proposal never happened. And after an intense year together, the relationship cooled, and the couple drifted apart.
She just kept saying things just not sitting right. She felt like this wasn't the right relationship.
Alexia decided to break things off with the intentions that they could remain friends. Emmanuel agreed.
After the breakup, Alexia threw herself back into her studies with no intention of dating again so soon. But fate had other plans.
Alexia had a friend named Jaden that she had known years before she even met Emmanuel.
Around the time things had fizzled with Emmanuel, Alexia and Jaden Young had reconnected. He was smart, he was funny, he was the kind of guy that everybody enjoyed being around.
He was like Alexia in that he never met a stranger. And they seemed to have a lot of fun together.
And with Alexia almost finished with school, some hoped there might still be a big engagement in her future.
He left a great impression on everyone.
I was really taken by him. I loved him as though he were the son that I never had.
But now, Alexia's future hangs in the balance.
Her sister has just found her unconscious and unresponsive inside of her apartment.
911.
She's not getting up, she's not moving.
She was covered in blood.
I remember Brittany telling me that she thought maybe she had fell and hit her head.
But when EMTs arrive on the scene, there's nothing they can do for Alexia.
Alexa was pronounced deceased at that time.
And it's quickly clear that her death is no accident.
First responders make a shocking discovery. Alexia has been shot.
She had sustained at least 2 gunshot wounds.
She had been murdered.
No.
Three-year-old Alexia Mayfield was on the verge of great things.
Alexia was looking forward to graduating with her pharmacy technician certification. She also had a promising new relationship with a guy named Jaden Young. The future appeared bright for Alexia.
But now, after Alexia's sister found her collapsed on the floor inside their apartment, EMTs have just pronounced her dead from at least 2 gunshot wounds.
Her body was found face down, so her sister could not tell that there were bullet wounds initially.
Never did she assume when she first came in the house, like, oh, my sister's dead.
When detectives arrive on the scene, they immediately begin to process the evidence.
We located 2 380 caliber shell casings in the bedroom beside the victim.
There was no weapon at the scene, so that led the police to rule out suicide.
But why had this young woman ended up dead? Given the area, detectives first consider the possibility that this was a random crime.
While the city is growing, and that's great for the economy, an increase in population can also lead to an increase in the crime rate.
Crime is definitely on the rise. Violent crime is on the rise.
And Alexia's neighborhood was no exception.
This could have been a robbery gone wrong.
It's a low-income area. Low-income housing, supported housing, or something like that. I guess the best way to describe it.
It was not a place I wanted for either of them to be. Not at all. But when children grow up to be adults, they have to respect where they are and the choices that they make.
However, a look around the scene quickly rules out that theory.
There were no signs of forced entry, and nothing was missing.
They found a tablet and a set of keys in Alexia's bedroom, so it didn't look like the killer had tried to take anything.
Instead, evidence at the crime scene suggests that whoever killed Alexia wasn't an intruder.
Detectives found a pizza box on the kitchen table, along with 2 half-empty glasses.
There was an empty bottle of bourbon.
Which let the police officers know that there was someone else who had been in the apartment that evening. Someone who Alexia knew.
Hoping that she might know who that someone was, detectives turned to Alexia's sister, Brittany.
Brittany was waiting outside while EMTs checked out her daughter. Even though she appeared to be unharmed, they wanted to be sure before releasing her.
We know this is hard, but we really need your help if we're gonna be able to find out who did this.
I'll try.
Brittany lost not only just her sister, but also her best friend.
Detectives begin by asking Brittany when she had last spoken to her sister.
I spoke to Alexia a couple times earlier when I was at work.
We talked periodically throughout the day. I would call and check up on her and my baby, see what they were doing.
Hey, what's up, girl?
Hey, Lexi. Did she eat yet?
Yeah, she had a good dinner. She's in the pack and play now, getting sleepy.
Lexi sound normal, sound happy.
But Brittany says that around 8 o'clock, Alexia stopped responding.
The phone just keep going straight to voicemail. She kept saying, that's not like her because she got my baby. I don't know what's going on, but I'm kind of worried. And then she was like, maybe I'm just worried for nothing.
I thought maybe she was just asleep.
When she first went in the house, she was like, girl, wake up.
But Alexia wasn't asleep.
No.
That's when she came to reality, like something else has happened.
Now it's up to detectives to determine exactly what that was.
We know this is very hard for you, ma'am. Is it a possibility that your sister may have gotten mixed up with some kind of trouble?
No, she was never in the streets or anything like that.
It wasn't like it was her past or her situation caught up with her.
Brittany also doesn't know for certain who could have come over that night.
Alexia didn't tell her she was expecting company.
However, Brittany does give detectives one possibility.
Alexia had recently started dating a gentleman named Jaden.
Were there any kind of problems between them that you're aware of?
No, sir.
He was very gentle with Alexia. He showed her nothing but respect.
Are there any ex-boyfriends we may need to talk to?
Well, there's Emmanuel.
Brittany gave us some backstory of that relationship, that the victim had recently broken up with Emmanuel.
Was there any bad blood between them?
I don't think so. I mean, they still hung out from time to time.
Emmanuel seemed to be okay with the breakup, and they seemed to be on good terms.
As far as the relationship being rocky, I didn't feel like that's what it was at all.
Thank you very much. We'll be in touch.
Brittany's statement doesn't give detectives much to go on, and neither does a canvas of the neighbors in Brittany's building.
We talked to a couple neighbors who earlier in the evening had heard a disturbance of some type coming from the apartment. They weren't sure what it was, but they did not call police.
But just when it looks like they're at a dead end, one of the building's security guards approaches detectives with what appears to be an important tip.
That security officer approached and gave us a name.
He says that the detective should check out a guy named Mark Briggs.
He said that name came from another resident that did not want to be identified.
They wanted to remain anonymous, so they didn't want to talk to the officers directly.
And according to the security guard, the neighbor had a good reason to remain anonymous.
Apparently, Mark Briggs was a dangerous criminal.
A security guard at the crime scene has just come forward and given detectives the name of a possible suspect in Alexia Mayfield's murder, a man named Mark Briggs.
The guard said that he had gotten the name from a resident of the apartment complex who had wanted to remain anonymous.
They didn't want to give us any information, didn't want to talk to us, but had provided that name to the security officer.
According to the informant, Mark Briggs was another resident of the complex who apparently had a thing for Alexia. The informant had also suggested that Mark was dangerous.
When detectives head back to the station and run Mark's name through their database, it appears that there may be something to the tip.
It turned out that he had a fairly extensive criminal record.
Most are petty theft and drug charges, but others raise red flags for detectives.
Mark has several domestic battery charges on his record.
There's also firearm violations.
When detectives bring Mark into the station first thing the next morning, he appears distraught about Alexia's death.
We assume that you're aware that Alexia Mayfield was murdered last night.
Everybody's talking about it. Can't believe that she's really gone.
Yeah, we heard you had a thing for her.
I guess you'll call it that.
He admits that they had become friends and that he wanted something a little bit more than friendship with her.
She was so pretty. She was always so nice.
But you guys never...
Nah.
Did you ask her out after she broke up with Emmanuel?
Yeah. She was seeing some other guy.
He realized that Alexia just wasn't into him like that. He backed off, and they remained friends.
But detectives wonder, how did Mark take getting turned down a second time?
So did that make you feel some type of way, seeing her with someone else?
I'm sorry.
Mark says he was okay being friends.
Although detectives wonder if they were still friends, maybe it was Mark who'd spent the evening with Alexia shortly before her murder.
Maybe he'd tried to make a move and things got out of hand.
When's the last time you saw Alexia?
Yesterday.
He said they had met up earlier that afternoon for coffee just to catch up.
At any point yesterday, were you in her apartment?
No. Do y'all think I had something to do with this? Listen. Y'all really want to know what happened to Alexia? I need to go question a new guy, Jaden.
Why is that?
He says that Alexia had been complaining about her relationship, that Jaden had become more controlling and more jealous.
Jealous enough that he'd followed her?
Maybe he was angry about Alexia hanging out with Mark and had confronted her about it.
Or was it possible Mark was making the whole thing up?
He could just be trying to throw them off of his tracks.
However, when police ask Mark where he was the previous night, he has an alibi ready.
Mark says that he went out to dinner with some friends, and later on they went to a club.
Detectives will need to follow up on Mark's alibi. But first, they contact Alexia's new boyfriend, Jaden Young.
They figure it's about time to bring Jaden in for questioning, too.
Since he was involved with Alexia at the time, they needed to rule him out.
So when did you find out that Alexia had been killed?
Last night. Her mother called me and I came straight over.
When Alexia was shot and killed, I was over to the apartment and Jaden walked in. Jaden walked in. And he felt his knees. And he said, Mama, I'm so sorry. He said, Mama, I'm so, so, so sorry. His sentiment and his sincerity brought me so much comfort.
But was it guilt or grief that evoked such a strong response to Alexia's death?
You know a guy named Mark Briggs?
Yeah. Yeah, he lives over there near Alexia.
You know, she met her for coffee yesterday afternoon, right?
Yeah, she might have mentioned it.
He never really sweated it because her and Mark were just friends.
He also claimed that things weren't all that serious between him and Lexi.
He said they had talked about stepping it up eventually once Alexia got out of school, but they just weren't really there yet.
Alexia was a diehard student. She wanted to get her education.
Do you own a gun, Jaden?
No, sir.
Where were you at last night?
I was working. At least until Lexi's mother called me.
He said he was driving for a rideshare service.
When detectives follow up with the rideshare service, their records confirm Jaden's alibi.
It appears that he was busy downtown and on the opposite side of Charlotte all evening.
But while Jaden's alibi checks out, when detectives speak to Mark's friends, what they learn puts him back on the suspect list.
It seems that he met up with his friends for dinner around 6:30. They left the restaurant around 8:30, and they didn't meet back up at the club until about 10:30. So that gives about an hour and a half window where Mark could have committed the crime.
He was definitely a person of interest.
After his alibi falls apart, detectives consider Alexia Mayfield's friend and neighbor, Mark Briggs, a possible suspect in her murder.
Not only did he have a violent history, he admitted that he had feelings for Alexia.
Maybe Mark had been pressing for something more, and maybe he got angry when Alexia rejected him. Since detectives couldn't account for his location for more than an hour around the time of the murder, he definitely could have had the opportunity to kill her.
But after detectives dig deeper, Mark's window of opportunity appears to close.
When detectives subpoena Mark's phone records for that evening to see whether he was in the vicinity of Alexia's apartment, it shows that he was pretty much in downtown Charlotte the entire night of the murder.
There was no indication that he had called or texted Alexia at any point that evening asking to come over.
It's not enough to rule him out completely, but it does suggest that he wasn't Alexia's killer.
However, a review of Alexia's phone records does reveal that she had been in contact with someone else prior to her death.
It seems as though she received several text messages in the hours leading up to the murder.
Detectives trace the number back to Alexia's former boyfriend, Emmanuel Felton.
He was going to be bringing some items over, returning them to her. One of those items being a tablet-style computer, also some keys. Those items were found in the apartment.
That's not the only indication that Emmanuel had come by either.
There was a text message that said that he was here, and we took that to mean that he was at the apartment.
When detectives run a background check on Emmanuel, there's no history of domestic violence.
They don't find anything other than a couple of minor possession charges.
However, they do find something that raises a red flag.
He had, in 2013, applied for a concealed handgun permit.
His application was denied, but the reason it was denied really raised some concerns. He indicated that he had sought or received mental health treatment, but he would not sign a HIPAA release in order to obtain mental health records.
Detectives needed to find out what kind of mental health issues Emmanuel had been dealing with, and if they played any role in Alexia's death.
Detectives are wondering if he managed to get his hands on a gun despite his denial for a gun permit.
The next question is, why would Emmanuel have wanted to harm Alexia? Detectives learn more about the couple's relationship when they speak to her close friend, Constance Williams.
We was more like sisters. She would confide in me.
Yes.
Constance tells detectives that Alexia had seemed happy with Emmanuel at first.
Lexi did love him. She introduced him to the family.
However, Constance also says that as the relationship progressed, friends and family saw less and less of Lexi.
She wasn't coming around as much. She would start taking the back seat more like, oh, girl, I can't. Oh, maybe next time. This wasn't the Lexi that I know. So I kept saying and asking her, like, Lexi, are you okay?
Constance says Lexi had eventually confessed that things with Emmanuel weren't going well.
Alexia shared that Emmanuel was very controlling and jealous, and he did not want her hanging out with any of her old friends.
He started pulling her away from her family and trying to make her feel like we were against her. We would go days without talking to her, without speaking to her. She would confide in me like, girl, I'm just aggravated. I'm frustrated with this relationship.
But she also had a hard time walking away.
Alexia really loved Emmanuel.
Lexi kept saying she wanted to get out of this relationship. Then next thing you know, she'd be like, oh, well, we're back on good terms. We're back together. Everything is okay.
However, the relationship continued to spiral out of control.
Emmanuel's behavior became increasingly irrational.
He would become agitated, kind of irrational.
Emmanuel even accused her of cheating on him, which Alexia vehemently denied.
She felt like something was wrong with him. She just couldn't put her hands on it. She just kept saying he was kind of crazy.
According to Constance, Alexia never uncovered anything about Emmanuel's apparent struggles with mental illness, but she did learn something disturbing.
Alexia found out that Emmanuel had started using drugs.
She was like, when he's not on it, he's so nice, he's so sweet, but when he is on it, it was more of the bad than the good.
The substance abuse definitely contributed to his erratic behaviors and controlling ways.
Constance also says that in addition to using drugs, Alexia suspected Emmanuel may have been dealing too.
He had a second stream of income, which always seemed to be a mystery to Alexia.
She kept saying, like, he got all this money. I don't know where it's coming from.
Worst of all, Constance says that Emmanuel's drug use made him violent.
She confided in me that he was being abusive. And I know of 3 instances where he has physically abused her.
But after a year of dating, Alexia finally had enough.
Alexia really couldn't take the emotional roller coaster anymore.
She was like, I'm finally leaving him, girl.
Constance says that Emmanuel appeared to take the breakup surprisingly well.
Basically, Emmanuel was on his best behavior, just like he was any time she had threatened to leave him in the past.
She was like, even though they were splitting, they were still gonna be on good terms. And I just think things is looking up for the better.
Especially once Alexia reconnected with Jaden.
Lexi did not stay put. She didn't just sit there. She didn't just wait for him to come back around again. She would go and do her own thing.
And now detectives suspect that Lexi moving on was Emmanuel's motive for murder.
It was just basically jealous.
He chose to do the unthinkable.
It was just, if I can't have you, Nobody else can.
We're not together!
Detectives trying to solve Alexia Mayfield's murder have reason to suspect the killer is her ex-boyfriend, 25-year-old Emmanuel Felton.
It's obvious from the phone records and text messages that he had been in communication with Alexia that evening and possibly was at the apartment.
One of Alexia's friends had also reached out to detectives with information about Emmanuel's past abuse.
I've seen hands-on physical abuse, emotional abuse. She kept telling me, girl, he's getting so controlling too. It's beyond bearable.
During the breakup, he had come to the apartment, he had returned the items, and something had happened after that point. He was the sole suspect.
But now that detectives have a prime suspect, they have to find him.
We began collecting information on Emmanuel Felton, finding out where he lives, his background information, where he might be.
They asked me, did I have any information about where he lived? And the only thing I knew at the time was where his grandmother lived. And we did ride over to see where the grandmother lived. So I pointed the house out.
Emmanuel isn't there, and he's not at his last known address, an apartment he'd shared with several roommates.
We did talk to the roommates, and they talked about how he would leave her there, and then he would think somebody was doing something with her or messing with her. He talked about Emmanuel often coming to them, you know, outside of Alexia, and like, hey, have you ever done anything with my girlfriend? And they would all say, no, we haven't done anything. But I think he was totally obsessed with the fact that she was cheating on him when, in fact, there's no evidence of that.
Next, detectives subpoena Emmanuel's cell phone records, which reveal his whereabouts on the night of the murder.
We obtained his cell phone records showing that he was at the scene when the incident happened.
The detectives also notice that there's a liquor store near Alexia's apartment and reach out to see if Emmanuel might have stopped there on his way over.
The liquor store confirmed that Emmanuel had been there and that he bought the same brand of bourbon that was found at Alexia's place.
We obtained video from the liquor store showing where he bought the liquor that was found inside the house.
Detectives have less luck tracking down Emmanuel's current location.
It looked like he might have turned his phone off after the murder because they weren't able to track him anymore.
It took him a little while to find Emmanuel. It took him a while.
In the end, it's a relative that gives up Emmanuel's location.
We get a phone call to 911 from a gentleman who says his cousin has come to his apartment. He's very upset, and he thinks that he's wanted for a homicide that had occurred.
The man said that he was Emmanuel Felton's cousin.
Within minutes, police arrive at the cousin's address.
Given that Emmanuel was possibly armed and apparently in a fragile mental state, it wouldn't have been hard for things to go wrong. Police are aware that sometimes suspects set themselves up for a suicide by cop situation. So law enforcement was concerned that that might be what was happening here.
But when they find Emmanuel huddled on the floor, it's obvious he's not looking for a fight.
He's sitting on the apartment floor, back against the wall, knees up, kind of head down in his hands. He's very upset, kind of spaced out.
Hey, Emmanuel.
I just sit down, start having a conversation with him. And ultimately, he says he will come to the law enforcement center and let us conduct an interview.
Emmanuel gave up without any resistance. He went along peacefully.
Emmanuel remains cooperative once down at the station and inside the interview room.
Part of the interview was just kind of getting a rapport with him, getting him talking. We talked about a lot of things, his history, where he's from, things he wanted to do with his life, and then began to talk to him more about having issues with the victim, Alexia.
Hey, I love that girl. She was never faithful.
He was obsessed with the fact that she was cheating on him. There's no evidence to say that, but in his mind, he thought she was cheating on him.
Alexia would constantly be accused of cheating by Emmanuel.
He felt like she was seeing somebody else. Went into great detail. He talked about, like, he would keep condoms in his trunk of his car, and then those condoms would go missing, and the only person that would have access to them would be her. And he would confront her about that, and she would say, oh, you're crazy, I'm not doing anything. His big thing was he didn't like being called crazy. That would essentially set him off.
Despite that, Emmanuel claims that on the night of the murder, he'd gone over to the apartment, hoping to patch things up with Alexia once more.
He wanted to bring the personal items that he kept after they broke up. He said he also brought her several gifts to apologize for how he had been behaving.
I'm sorry I got so angry.
I appreciate that.
They were having a good time, eating some pizza and drinking a little bourbon.
But at some point, things took a deadly turn.
Most likely, Emmanuel suggested they get back together, or he might have even tried to make a move on Alexia.
No, Emmanuel, no.
The conversation became heated. He became angry.
I felt like he knew that this time it was over.
So what happened? I don't know.
His whole story was that he blacked out. He doesn't remember.
No, we're not together. What are you talking
about? Emmanuel Felton has surrendered to detectives investigating the murder of his ex, 23-year-old Alexia Mayfield.
Officers begin to question him, and Emmanuel admits that he went over to Alexia's apartment that night.
He was, quote unquote, dropping her clothes off. That's how he got access to the apartment.
However, Emmanuel claims not to know how Alexia died.
His whole thing was that he didn't remember what happened. He had blacked out. He wasn't sure he had done anything to anyone, that he had hurt anyone.
You don't remember shooting Alexia?
I was messed up.
He was saying he didn't remember because he was hazed because of drugs.
Emmanuel tells police that he had been on a 7-day drug binge prior to the murder.
Emmanuel had a substance abuse issue, and oftentimes with substance abuse, people are hiding from their feelings or hiding to deal with their true issues, so they mask that or they numb it with the drugs. And I think that's what happened with Emmanuel.
He says that he had no sleep and that he had become increasingly obsessive and paranoid in the days that followed.
He would kind of hide behind the thing of, I was in a fog, I didn't know what I was doing.
You shot her, Emmanuel, twice.
She's dead because of you. Oh, God.
He breaks down crying, saying that he never meant to hurt her. It's just that the drugs made him go crazy.
He ultimately admitted that he remembered firing one shot that struck Alexia and then left the apartment. He said he woke up in a haze driving his car. He had a gun on him, and he threw it out the window.
Emmanuel's confession is more than enough for detectives to file charges, even if they don't believe much of it.
I believe he entirely knew what he was doing and what had happened. At the closing interview, he was charged with first-degree murder.
When friends and family learn of Emmanuel's arrest, they agree with the detective's suspicion that Emmanuel's blackout story is a lie.
There's no doubt in my mind. Emmanuel Felton came to the house that night with the intentions on killing her. Because he normally doesn't carry a gun on him. He got the gun from somebody. He was like, if I can't have you, can't nobody else have you.
Many women who try to flee and leave in volatile and violent situations of domestic violence end up dying. The statistics are astounding. It's an astronomical amount of people.
Still, family and friends are glad Alexia's killer is in custody.
It was relief. We were grateful. We were happy. But we were still sad at the same time. Just because he's arrested, that doesn't bring Lexi back.
I was relieved. But I really wanted to go and talk to him so that I could understand how this man who said he loved my daughter so much could do something so dastardly, something so cowardly. How could he have done such a thing?
The only thing that I still want to know is why. Why?
Alexia's loved ones also wish she had been more forthcoming about Emmanuel's abuse.
By the time I saw that, okay, something's not right, to be honest, it was too late.
They never argued in front of me.
Often with domestic violence, people don't want outsiders to know what's going on with them.
Because, of course, she knows what my response is gonna be. Leave him alone. I would have been pretty insistent on it. You see those characteristics that you don't want. You see that they're manipulative. You see that he is very possessive. Leave him.
But in the end, Alexia's family will never get the answers they deserve.
With his trial approaching, Emmanuel's attorneys approach prosecutors about a possible plea deal. Emmanuel's attorney pushes the drug binge theory to argue for a more lenient sentence.
He was on a 7-day binge from what they said, but I really think he said that to make his story sound more sympathetic.
Before the trial is set to begin, the defense and prosecutors make a deal.
He ultimately took a plea deal and pled to second-degree murder and was sentenced to 16 years in prison.
I thought, 16 years? Why? And the lawyer had explained because Emmanuel was dealing from a diminished capacity because he'd spent so much time doing drugs. If he had gone to court, if there was a trial, there would have been a possibility that he could get less time. And of course, nobody wanted that.
I'm an eye for an eye person. You kill somebody, you deserve to spend your life in prison. However, I understand the justice system. I understand how things and how cases get resolved. Not always what we want, but there's also, you gotta understand how the system is and how the system works. And I think justice was served in this case.
Not that everyone finds the outcome satisfying.
16 years is not long enough. The fact that he gets to walk this earth again after 16 years of being in jail, it's not fair whatsoever. It's not fair at all.
16 years for the cold-blooded murder of a young lady who had nothing but a bright future ahead of her, to me, does not seem fair. I would have argued for a much longer sentence, a much stricter, harsher sentence.
As far as justice being served in this manner, only God will be able to cause justice to be served in this aspect of everything that has taken place. Only God. The greatest justice that I could ask for is, again, never to lay eyes on that young man again. I have forgiven him because I need forgiveness for whatever. I walk in forgiveness, so I extend that forgiveness. But if I never see him again, if I never lay eyes on him again, that would suit me so well. Emmanuel all but got away with murder.
And he will eventually get a second chance at life that Alexia never will.
Emmanuel Felton get to hear his family every day, get to talk to his family, get to see his family. We don't get that from Lexi.
I will never see my daughter on this side.
We would never get to hear Lexi's voice in person. We would never get to see Lexi face to face. That was robbed from us.
But Alexia's mother has made it her mission to ensure that her daughter didn't die in vain.
I've helped different people coordinate domestic violence conferences, and I'm in the process of doing that now. And if I were to share one thing concerning domestic violence, concerning volatile relationships, it would simply be to say, it's okay to love somebody, but never love anybody more than you love yourself. Never do that.
Thank you.